Andrew, that is a perfect who's down to take us into topic one, which for me is pretty much the only topic for of the week. We have more topics coming in, but it's such a big potential story about how people are going to be consuming media and watching games going forward.
No doubt about it. So let's kitchen table this, John. This is kind of, I said at the beginning, this is the Super Bowl of the carriage disputes. You've been covering these forever. There is a feeling that this might be different. Now, let us say that we're taping this. The podcast comes out Wednesday morning. We're taping it on Tuesday afternoon. But as of right now, it's a complete standoff. Yes, the two sides are discussing what to do, but it's affecting 15 million people, around 15 million Spectrum subscribers who do not have any of the Disney channels, which in our neck of the woods means ESPN, ABC, all the ESPN channels. So what should people know just to understand it at first?
People should know that this could take a while, because for as long as there's been a cable business, you have had these types of disputes to where programmers want more money and distributors don't want to pay as much money. And for decades, for the past 30 years, 35 years, the programmers have held all of the leverage. And if you look at what ESPN is doing right now, they're using a playbook that was developed back in the 1990s. They had their deal end at the end of August, going into a long holiday weekend where college football started. Next week, you're going to have the NFL on Monday Night Football. And then you're going to just have a wave of college football game after college football game after NFL game. US Open also is going on. And they're depending on angry sports fans calling up the cable system and saying, like, you know, we're leaving you for DirecTV or YouTube TV or whatever have you, and we're gone. And faced with the prospect of losing those subscribers, the cable operators like Charter, like Comcast, always buckled, always came to a deal. This is different. This is totally different, because my who's up, Cable One, that small cable operator has showed that cable has a very healthy business if they just focus on broadband and they focus on wireless instead of having of paying increasing costs for these programmers. And the reason why I feel that this one is different is because of the way Charter has been acting. So when people call up to complain or to cancel their subscription, they're sending these subscribers to FuboTV and they're saying, like, we just want to make sure that you stick with us with broadband, because you need our broadband in order to stream ESPN off FuboTV. Hopefully we can bundle in wireless as well. But they're already sort of pointing their own subscribers to where they should go if they're angry. They're not trying to keep these subscribers by saying, oh, this will be done in a week and we'll tie up all the loose ends. It's a totally unique way of looking at things. And if this strategy works out, it will show that the leverage, which for the past 30 years have been with the programming networks, has actually turned and it's now with the cable operators.
Now, I know Moffitt Nathanson did report that they're doing that. They are doing that. But I will tell you, like, I have Spectrum. So when you try, this is like disgusting, in my opinion. When you try to cancel Spectrum online, they don't let you. They'll let you add stuff. Like, so I've gone through it and I said, oh, let me add something. They'll let you do that. If you want to cancel, you have to call, and then it's hours and hours of delay. So they might be interested, as you said, in getting out of the video business. They're not that interested in you or I getting out of the Spectrum watching their video business. Like, they're not very helpful in allowing you to do that. So I think that, to me, is gross. Now, I know that's...
But you have firsthand knowledge. That's been the history of the cable television. There's a reason that it's difficult to cancel. One thing that that Michael Nathanson of Moffitt Nathanson reported as well, that is probably going to change. And I'm curious to see if it does, where you have a QR code that you're going to be able to click on, get rid of video, keep broadband, and add different things, making a one click.
That would be smart. And I think what you're talking about in terms of what's in danger for Spectrum is their brand. And, you know, is their brand going to be hurt by the fact that, you know, the way these things usually go is now people blame Spectrum for not providing ESPN and the Disney channels for them. This is different in the sense of they have agreed to raise cable fees for the Disney suites of channels. That's been agreed to. The direct to consumers, Charter feels like and Spectrum feels like those should be provided freely. Now, when I talk to both sides, I go at these people and just try to give the devil's advocate. The thing I don't understand on the Spectrum side of it, again, let me just preface this. For the consumer, this is like a choice. Rooting for either Spectrum or Disney is like choosing between being hit in the face and hit in the stomach. So it's like there's nobody, you're not rooting for, it's hard to root for anybody here. That said, if you look at the history of how these disagreements have gone, when ESPN has added ESPN2, for example, they got more money because there's more programming, more games, especially that they were offering. Now with ESPN+, where we exist, they've added more games. I don't understand the Spectrum position, just the history of how things have gone, that they should not have to pay for that extra programming. As a consumer, I would say, yeah, I'm already paying enough. Great. But ESPN and Disney have spent billions of dollars for those. I don't understand how you could say, well, they shouldn't be paid for them based off of past history. Why is that wrong? Give me the Spectrum side of it, or what you think of that.
All right. The Spectrum side of this is that if you go back to 1992 or 1991, when they launched ESPN2, it was exclusive to cable. There was no possibility of having anything go to direct to consumer. If you take a look at ESPN Plus, which is not ESPN, that's not ESPN's direct to consumer, it still has a lot of events that are on ESPN that have migrated over to ESPN Plus. And on top of this, you have in your Who's Down, Bob Iger talking about, it's not if we're going to go direct to consumer with ESPN, it's when. So all of a sudden ESPN is launching a competitive direct-to-consumer service to Charter Spectrum, and they're turning around and asking Charter Spectrum for a pretty significant raise in what they pay to have ESPN. These deals typically go like 4 years. I mean, Charter knows in 4 years, ESPN's going to have launched its direct-to-consumer service for ESPN and ESPN2. And Charter's going to be stuck there paying some sort of exorbitant cost with a channel that has to go to the majority of its customers and saying, like, look, we can aggregate your consumer services. I understand why Disney says no to this, but if you're Charter, you're saying we're already spending too much on programming. We're not making money on programming. If it doesn't work, then we'll just become a broadband and wireless company. Like, we don't need to provide that video.
Yeah, I don't disagree with Spectrum for saying, like, you guys are openly talking about creating another business that's going to be an alternative for this, right? For the ESPN and, you know, especially ESPN. That said, and like, you know, I don't understand why, though, you wouldn't agree to, and maybe they've discussed this, that you could get these channels at a discount through Spectrum. How is that not a win-win for everybody?
So, Andrew, how much do you pay for Spectrum?
$268.
$268 a month. And how big is your expanded basic tier? And they're losing to cord cutting all these people.
But, John, they've agreed to continue that and charge me my $268. They're cool with that.
They haven't agreed to it. Well, okay, I'm sorry. They obviously did agree to it. However, the leverage has always been with the programmers, and they jammed this through. And finally, they jammed it through to such an extent that they're saying, this doesn't make financial sense for us anymore.
But it does. They're saying no because they're agreeing. That from what I've been told, it's been reported elsewhere, they've agreed to the fees,
but it's under a ton of conditions that are untenable to Disney. So I love when Charter says this. It's like, oh, we agreed to pay the rate, but they were going to knock.
But this is my question to you. Like, again, it's between being hit in the face and hit in the stomach. Okay. So I'm not like taking a side here in terms of who you're rooting for here, but like they're offering with ESPN Plus and Disney Plus more programming. They're offering more. Like, should they just put that on ESPN? You know, you could argue that, but there's not enough space on ESPN. ESPN can only put one game on at a time. With direct-to-consumer, you can put more. So why would it make more sense that, yes, it's on basic, right? What we have now is on basic. But then that they have an agreement where a potential direct-to-consumer or ESPN Plus you can get at a discounted rate, maybe a couple of dollars off. Wouldn't that be a win-win for both?
I think that that's going to come out in the negotiations. And so we'll see where that price comes out. And despite my doom and gloom, I still believe that Charter's not ready to give up on video and that there's going to be a deal to be had at some point.
Will that be the end game? Because like, that's where I don't really understand. Again, if you're adding more programming, I'm getting more games. Is it too expensive? Maybe. Yeah, I agree. It's all too expensive. It stinks. I think the solution to me for both places, where's the win-win for both these places, is that yes, make it so the best option is for you or I to keep cable and then be able to add ESPN Plus, you know, and then when they go mothership direct to consumer, you figure out where the sweet spot in terms of the payment is there, where it's discounted on cable as compared to what you'd have to pay if you're going direct to consumer. That seems to make more sense. And maybe, again, we always say this when we talk about negotiations, this is with the Pac-12. Yes, they're fighting right now. We don't know. We have to wait till they're in the end zone, right? Or if they never get in the end zone, where that comes out. So maybe this is where the negotiations are. And if you're Charter, you start at zero. Like, we're not paying anything. And then, you know, that's a great stance to take, because then if you get the number you want in terms of this add-on, that to me makes sense. That's how you get to a solution.
You have blinders on right now for this one specific deal. But yep. if you've been listening for the past decade to cable operator executives, they've been telling us that video is it's maybe not a loss leader, but they're not making any money off of video. It's something that they had in as a bundle to get broadband subscribers. And I think it was 2013, Jim Dolan owned Cablevision before he sold it off to Altice. And he said back in 2013, he sees a day when he doesn't offer video at all. I mentioned Cable One a bunch of times. They've done without video. You look at Dish Network, and Charlie Ergen decided regional sports networks cost too much. We're getting rid of regional sports networks. Every single cable operator executive looked at Dish Network after he did that and saw that the revenues went up, profits went up, and it ended up being a good business deal for them. So this is its individual deal, but there's 10 years, 20 years of particularly sports networks charging as much as they can. And cable's finally is saying, we can't afford this. And it's we saw this coming. The question is whether this is going to be the tipping point or whether it happens in 4 years, but it's clearly happening.
Okay. Now people are listening to this, let's assume that no deal has been done. I think this weekend is a key point because you have Texas, Alabama, you have the U.S. Open Finals, you have in New York, very interesting, Aaron Rodgers' debut against the Bills. I mean, those are three must-have programming. If you're in certain areas of the country, those are must-haves.
Let me ask you a question specific to you and specific to Monday Night Football. It's on over the air.
You can't get ABC.
You can get it through an antenna. I mean, do you have the capability of doing that? Would you even know how to do that?
No, I mean, I could look it up. But I mean, I'm sure I can figure it out. But like the thing about all this is a pain in the butt. I mean, that's why it's so maddening that like you're telling me at one hand that, you know, Spectrum wants to make it easy for me to go get ESPN someplace else. And then I got to take 3 hours to cancel it. I mean, my situation is like, I'm not like I haven't done anything yet. I'm going to, of course, but I didn't do it this weekend. I wanted to feel like what this was, right? And I tried to, you know, the games that I wanted to watch and stuff I wanted to watch. I mean, there were great games that I wanted to watch on NBC and Fox this weekend. And so I just focused on those. But like over time, of course, I'm going to get ESPN. But I don't think they're really making it easy. The idea that they're making it easy, they're not. Like Chris Canty, you know, does radio and TV for ESPN. He tweeted out, he was on the call for 2-3 hours trying to cancel his Spectrum. And so it's like, and now, you know, they're going the full court press in terms of getting the word out there. But the bottom line is here's my question for you. How does this end?
How does this end? within a month, there will be a deal done. 4 years from now, I don't know. I mean, I think we can clearly see that Charter is willing to go without video, and it's willing to focus on broadband and wireless as its two main services. And you are going to be stuck having to go to Hulu or YouTube TV or Fubo TV or, you know, take your pick on that.
But the thing is, we also missed one thing. Maybe you said it and I missed it. But the favored nation clause is very important here, because if they do this deal with Spectrum, it applies to everybody else as well. So like, they can't do a deal that's not tenable for the whole ecosystem. And so that's why this deal is not just like a one-off, like, oh, they want to deal with them. If they do this kind of deal where they kind of gave the direct-to-consumer products to Spectrum for, quote, free — they're not free because obviously there's a lot of fees associated with the ESPN and Disney channels. But that's something that's very important to note, because it's not just the Spectrum deal. It's a deal with everybody. And so all these other cable companies are rooting them on to fight this fight, so they don't have to, and they can reap the benefits.
And they're rooting Charter on because Charter is uniquely positioned to be the big cable operator to fight this. Because if you look at Comcast, it owns NBC. It owns a lot of programming networks. It would have a lot harder time trying to hold this kind of line based on what its assets are. DirecTV, they don't really have a broadband business. They are dependent on cutting deals for these types of channels as well. Charter's uniquely — they have a couple of RSNs in LA. They don't have national networks, and they're uniquely positioned to do this.
I got a question for you. Okay, we have the Brady meter. All right, I feel like that might be my sweet spot. We need the Ourand meter. Wait, let me think. No, does this work? The Ourand odometer.
I like it.
All right, the Ourand odometer.
Ourand odometer.
Ourand odometer. By Monday Night Football, is there a deal done between Charter, Spectrum, and Disney?
I love this prediction because it could be totally wrong by tomorrow, but I say there's no chance there's a deal done before Monday Night Football. I think that both sides want to see what happens after Monday Night Football, and there could be one soon after Monday Night Football, or there could be one a couple weeks after Monday Night Football, but that's a game and frankly a weekend that you should have circled, because that's going to determine a lot.
I was looking for a percentage, but you went full out.
Okay. You know what? Yeah. If you're — I'm all in. 0% chance. 0%.
This operation had a 0% chance of succeeding.
Let me check and see if the odometer is plugged in right now. It's still down at zero. Yeah.